Professor, there's a quote from you. The Big Bang is a mirror. Explain.
So this is a new hypothesis we're exploring. It is, I would say, a development of an approach Stephen Hawking proposed. Hawking was obviously wondering about how the universe could come out of a singularity. And that's maybe the most fundamental mystery in cosmology and basic physics. How did everything we see come out of a single point? That's what the Einstein equations imply, and it's very mysterious indeed. So Hawking's picture was very geometrical. He said, let's trace the Big Bang back to the singularity. Space is shrinking to a very small point. We can sort of think of this like a cone whose tip is sharp. And so if you like the cross sections of the cone, as you go up the cone, that's time, and the cross sections denote space. And so the cross sections are a circle, which is shrinking to a point at the Big Bang. So Hawking's idea was to essentially round off that sharp tip by going to imaginary time instead of real time. So as long as you solve the Einstein equations in real time, the existence of a singularity is unavoidable. One can show that you're just forced to hit a singularity at the Big Bang. This is Hawking's singularity theorem. But if you make time become, instead of going along the real axis of the complex plane towards t equals zero, if it makes a bend and goes up the imaginary axis, then the space becomes Euclidean, not Lorentzian. So the metric is plus dt squared plus dx squared. And if that's the case, then the Euclidean Einstein equations allow you to round off the space in a smooth, nose of the cone rather than a sharp tip. So that was his sort of trick for avoiding the singularity. So I worked on this for many years. What's appealing about it is that you sort of avoid the chicken and the egg problem in cosmology. You know, the chicken and the egg problem is what came before. And if time is infinite into the past, there's always a before. And so you just end up endlessly asking what came before that and before that and before that. If instead you do have some theory of a boundary or boundary condition, let's say, at the Big Bang singularity, that sort of resolves the question of what there was before. So it's a much more minimal picture of the universe. It is the most minimal picture, is that somehow what happened in the beginning is there's just a boundary condition. And Hawking proposed a particularly simple one. His proposal is that there is no beginning boundary. Okay, so if I imagine a rounded cone, as I go down the side of this cone, well, there's no special singular point. No point is any different than any other, really, near the beginning. It's just kind of the surface of a sphere near the tip of the cone. And so that just avoids the question of what caused everything else. So I was very taken with this idea, but worked on it for several years and found it didn't work. Hawking's proposal predicts that the universe is empty, not full of radiation. And it took me a while to see that the problem is really that Hawking tried to realize his idea in the context of inflation. So inflation is a very hypothetical picture of the early universe, which postulates that the universe was dominated by a strange form of energy called inflationary energy, and that causes the universe to expand exponentially. And the reason people like the idea is that it seems to explain why the universe is so smooth and flat and isotropic today, because you essentially just sort of blow up a small patch and stretch it out into something much flatter and smoother. I've never been a big fan of inflation, because you sort of get out what you put in.
What do you mean?
you postulate a new form of energy, and then you dial all of its properties so that the resulting universe fits the observations we see. So literally, you don't get any definite prediction. You just get out what you put in. So normally what people do is they assume there's an extra scalar field which has this type of potential energy which can drive inflation. And then you find all the predictions of the theory depend on the details of that potential energy, which is a free function. And so unfortunately, there are no really precise predictions of inflation. It's just what we call a fit. You know, you just dial the shape of this potential to match what we see.
Now, for people who are listening, what would be the difference between that and, say, the standard model, which has some parameters that you then go and experimentally find out?
The difference is that with inflation, the standard model does not give inflation. Okay. So none of the forms of energy in the standard model are of the right type to give inflation of the kind we need.
What I meant to say is, like, let's imagine that you have some formula and now you have to go and measure in order to fit the curve that you measure, the experimental data.
Right, right.
But that's a characteristic of almost any scientific enterprise that's mathematically modeled. So what's the difference between inflation and, say, the standard model, which is similar in that regard?
The standard model is built on some rules of consistency, theoretical consistency, which are very strong. And so that's the requirement that the theory is consistent with quantum mechanics and relativity. And that severely constrains the number of parameters you can include. So for example, in the standard model, there's the idea of renormalizability. You have a certain number of parameters, then you calculate all the quantum corrections in the model, and all of those corrections are parameterized by a very small number of parameters. It's about 20 parameters in the standard model. That sounds like a large number, but in fact, the number of different observations are you know, millions or billions. So it's actually a tiny number of parameters for as compared to the number of physical phenomena you're predicting.
So the
standard model is very highly constrained by requirements of theoretical consistency. Now, the problem with inflation is you are trying to couple the standard model of quantum fields to gravity. And nobody quite knows how to do that. So when people started building inflation models, they essentially relaxed the rules to say, okay, well, we don't really know what's needed for consistency. So let's just allow scalar fields who are not consistent with renormalizability and all the other requirements in standard model physics. So they ended up with a sort of slew of models, like tens of thousands of different inflationary models. They all give different predictions. And unfortunately, the observations are not pointing to any one of them. The simplest inflation models were ruled out several years ago. There's one sort of smoking gun signal of inflation, and that's the prediction that this explosive phase of the early universe should have given rise to gravitational waves, very long wavelength gravitational waves, which sort of created by this sudden expansion of space. But the observations are now bearing down very strongly on gravitational waves. So whereas the simplest inflation model predicted they would be about 20% of the CMB signal, you know, when we look at the cosmic microwave background, we see these fluctuations, we can tell what fraction of those fluctuations were due to gravitational waves. The simplest inflation models predict about 20%. The slightly less simple models predict, at least about 10%. The observations are now at 3%. And in the next 3 years, they will fall to 0.3%.
That's a prediction of yours?
No, this is everybody accepts that inflation predicts gravitational waves at some level.
I'm sorry, Professor. What I meant was, is it a prediction that it will fall from 3 to 0.3?
Oh, yeah, sorry. Yes, that's not my prediction. It's the prediction of the experimentalists.
I see.
The experimentalists are doing a fantastic job of measuring how much of the signal in the cosmic microwave anisotropy is due to gravitational waves. And what they found is much less. There are much less gravitational waves than sort of simple inflation models predict. And their upper limit is coming down and down and down. Mm-hmm. And as it comes down, it makes it more and more difficult to build a consistent inflation model. You can do it, and you will always be able to do it, but right. The model becomes more and more contrived and less compelling. Now, I would contrast that. So inflation, I just emphasize, is a kind of phenomenological fit. That's what I would say. You're just parameterizing some observations with some arbitrary functions. It's not a theory at the level of Einstein's theory of gravity or Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism. I mean, both of those are very clear theories, very, very highly principled theories that are not very adjustable. And, you know, they predict what they predict, and either they're right or wrong. And that's why they're interesting. So, and in both cases, there are thousands or millions of observations which confirm the detailed predictions of the theory without any need to adjust parameters. You know, Maxwell's theory of electromagnetism and light has, you know, no free parameters in it. And it fits perfectly. All phenomena involving electromagnetism and light. Einstein's theory of gravity likewise fits perfectly. All the observations we have of black holes and so on. So I guess I've never been a fan of inflation because it always seemed somewhat ad hoc and more like a fit than a theory. But obviously it's very challenging to try and make a more compelling theoretical framework, which is much more rigid, doesn't involve all these arbitrary functions and parameters, and is consistent with everything we see. So essentially what we've done recently with the mirror universe proposal is modify Hawking's initial idea to be an idea about the beginning of the universe, the boundary condition at the beginning, which does not involve inflation. Inflation is not needed in our proposal. And nevertheless, we're close, I would say, to having a complete description and understanding of exactly what the Big Bang singularity is. Okay, so that's what motivates me. Is, you see, another way of saying it is that particle physicists for the last 50 years or more, preceded by every time a new phenomenon was discovered, they added a new field or particle.
Right.
So there were certain electrons and protons were known, and then they couldn't really understand the structure of the nucleon, so they added quarks, and then there were gluons, and that all worked very well, but then new accelerators came along, they found new particles, they kept adding more generations of fermions. So basically, the mode of operation of the field was you build a bigger accelerator, discover a new particle, add some more stuff to the standard model. That stopped working around 1980. Essentially in the 70s, the current framework of the standard model was all in place, and no accelerator since that time has discovered anything extra, right? So all the major theoretical ideas were in place in the late 70s. And so far, the bigger accelerators we've built, we've not found any new particles that weren't already predicted. And so this is kind of shocking. The Large Hadron Collider, you know, was built to find the Higgs boson. It did, but that was predicted in the 60s. Most theorists were predicting there would be a slew of new particles, right? Instead, we find nothing. And so I am very interested in the idea that perhaps we do know all the laws of physics. They're sitting in front of us. Einstein's theory of gravity, we've got the Standard Model. The challenge for cosmology is understanding how these things work together. It's not so much adding new ingredients, you know. I believe it may be true that we don't need any new ingredients. All we need is to understand how the ingredients we already know fit together. So my philosophy has become one of extreme minimalism.
Right.
Let's try to explain everything we see with the minimum number of theoretical principles.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.